Can you see them?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, it's visible.
So, great morning to all of you. And I'm indeed very happy to be with all of you and want to thank PEC, that is Punjab Educational Engineering College, ACM chapter, for inviting me and giving me an opportunity to talk on the topic, which is very close to my heart. And the topic, we will be looking at the topic from very basic level. We will try to understand what are the characteristics of blockchain. And by the time you complete this session, probably you will have a fair understanding on how blockchain functions, you know, what are the intricate characteristics of blockchain. So let's start. Your chair has already introduced me, so this is not needed. Only thing which I want to highlight is, like, apart from my journey in academia and also in corporate, I have also formed a professional society in 2018 by name Society for Data Science. And we are trying to reach worldwide, and we have been successful also. And it's very good feeling to have a community of like-minded people, people who are working on similar interest areas, various applications, and it's doing very well. Couple of awards just to prove the credibility of my work. And here we go. So this image on your screen says that basically there's a conversation between a boss and the manager. The boss asks, like, where should we focus this year? And the manager tries to be look smart and current, and he says that, okay, blockchain, right? So, and he continues saying that it will change everything. Everybody is talking about it. It has got potential applications, and it is endless. You can apply it everywhere and anywhere, you know. And if we do not adopt it, probably we will not be in the race in the corporate world, you know. So, manager asks, like, what exactly is the blockchain? And this associate suddenly changes the topic. He said, okay, we should be good with artificial intelligence also. So basically, it's like everybody is talking about blockchain. It is in vogue, but essentially not understanding what it is, you know. So from where to start, how to start, they are fumbling. So this is basically to say that everybody is talking, but they are not understanding what it is, right? So we will try to understand, as I told you, we will try to understand in the next 40 minutes what are the various important elements of blockchain. And probably after that, you will understand and appreciate how blockchain can change many things in times to come. Let me explain you with a simple example. Simple example with you, me, everyone can relate to. So you can see that these are four boys who wants to play cricket, and cricket is like played everywhere in our country, you know. So they also want to play some Kali cricket, and they form their own rule. That, okay, if ball goes this side, it will be 2. If it goes to that end, it will be 4. And if it goes there, then it will be 6, and so on and so forth. And somebody says that, okay, if it goes up the roof, then it will be out. So they form some rule, mutually consented rule, right? And they start playing. But then they realize, like, they want somebody who can keep a record of their scores, right? So they see that there is a boy who is watching them, and also having ice cream and spending time watching their match from a corner of the street. So they try and request him that, would you be able to keep a record of our game? So boy agrees for that, you know, and he started keeping, like, how many wickets taken, how many overs balled, and how many runs till now. So he starts maintaining the record of various aspect of the game, right? But then after some time, he finishes his ice cream and he loses interest in keeping the record, and he says, no, I don't want to do this, I want to go back. But then these boys never wanted to stop the game in between, you know. So one of the boys says that, okay, I'll get you some ice cream, please have another one and keep doing your job, what you were doing, right? So boy again is happy doing the work and continues doing it. But then now there is a bias in boy's mind towards the boy who had given him ice cream, you know. So even if the boy is out, he will not give him out. So there's a bias, you know, because the ice cream was given to him by this boy, right? And after some time, so data is not correct now. You know, the data which he was recording is not correct now. There's a bias in that. And after some time, his mom comes and she takes him away. You know, she says, now it's too late. We have to go back home. And again, the data is all lost. The boys are like, what to do now? So somebody suggested, okay, now what we can do is like each one of us can maintain the record in our own mind. Okay. So what will happen that in case if I'm in a doubt, then I'll ask rest three of you, right? And whatever majority says will be accepted and I'll correct my record then. So everybody accepted and it went very fine. In between, one boy said like, okay, it's 7:30 now, I have to go back home. So he went back, but still data is there. So there's no loss of data in this situation. Now, this is exactly how blockchain works, you know, distributed fashion. All the information at all the nodes, right? I'm sure this example will help you understand what are the drawbacks of centralized system. If you keep everything at central location, probably, I mean, there can be erroneous entry, there can be intentional mistake, somebody can run away with the data. But with blockchain, all those things are not possible, right? And the same thing I wanted to tell you through this example, simple example, right? Now, before I jump into the characteristic which I have promised I'll be sharing with all of you today, let's look at the history of the blockchain technology. Now, when did you hear for the first time about the blockchain? In 2008, all of us we know. In 2008, when Satoshi Nakamoto came out with that research paper, which was essentially not about blockchain, it was about Bitcoin, right? And in that paper, he mentioned something about blockchain. But it all started much before that. You know, it's not 2008, which is the starting point of blockchain or Bitcoin. It started much before that, around 20 years back, you know, 1990, when we started moving towards digital from cash. So the first product which came into this effect was DigiCash, which was in 1991, and it uses many concepts like blind signature, anonymous network, secret sharing. All those things were used, and it was a very strong product. But it failed because it was much ahead of its time. You know, internet had just started. E-commerce, I mean, people were skeptical about e-commerce. So because it was much ahead of time, it failed, you know. Then in 1992, few people came together and started writing their ideas about privacy is not secrecy. And these people were just the propagator of the idea, you know, which is privacy is not secrecy. And the people were not essentially from computer science background or mathematic background. They were from all the walks of life, and they were trying to create awareness about their thought process. In 1997, Adam Back came with another product called Hashcash, and this product used a concept of proof of work and used hash cryptography and allows the communication, you know. So this was in 1997. Then in 1998, the concept of B-money was given by Weitai, you know. And this was never implemented ever, but then on paper, as a research paper, it was a very strong research paper which talked about anonymous distributed electronic cash system. Okay. And then 2005, BitGold was launched, and which used the concept of timestamp, hash cash, and cryptographic puzzle. And in 2008, Bitcoin came into picture, you know. Now, we came to know about Bitcoin only when Satoshi Nakamoto published a paper, okay? And this was essentially about Bitcoin as an application on the top of the framework, which is known as blockchain. So this paper, as I told you, this paper was not essentially about blockchain. It was about, just give me 1 second. It was about Bitcoin, but it made a mention of blockchain also. But two people who were actually involved were Stuart Haber and Scott Stornetta. Okay, they were working since so many years prior to 2008 on the concept of timestamping a digital document, right? And which is the foundation of the infrastructure of blockchain. So if I have to just give you a concise picture of how it all evolved, it's like 1990s to 2008, it was all background work which were doing, which the research community were doing, you know, and Stuart Haber and Scott played a very, very critical role in that, in laying down the foundation of blockchain. Then Satoshi came with the concept of application, Bitcoin, which is an application on that framework, right? So initial phase can be thought of as a Bitcoin emergence, or maybe blockchain 1.0, where we focused only on transactions on this platform. Now here in phase one, the transaction was in the term of Bitcoin, financial transaction, you can call it. Then blockchain 2.0 was like finding out whether only a commercial transaction can be done, or financial transaction can be done, or we can store a few more things like contract between two parties, contract between few people. So can we store that also in secured fashion? So blockchain 2.0 was all dedicated to that. And blockchain 3.0 is about endless application of this platform. Bitcoin is one of the application. Please remember that. Okay, Ethereum is one of the application. Now, if I have to define this, why should I struggle? Let me take something from Wikipedia, what Wikipedia has to say. A blockchain is a continuously growing list of record, the record which continuously grows, which we call as block, and they're linked to each other and secured using cryptography. So cryptography is there, link is there, data is there. So many things are there put together in blockchain. We can also define it as a new type of database or transaction management system. It is an open, decentralized, distributed database ledger that can. So decentralized, that means it is not centralized. It is at multiple location. Open, that means it is for public use. Anybody and everybody can see. Distributed, that means it's available to everyone, you know. That can record transaction between two parties. That can track the business network. It can track the tangible asset also. It can track intangible asset also. Tangible asset can be house, car, cash, land, whatever, you know. And it can also track intangible assets like your intellectual property, your documents, your patents, copyright, branding. So all those things also can be saved, secured properly on blockchain. And also not only record and track, and also maintain the continuously growing list of record, which are known as blocks, in a verifiable and permanent way. Verifiable, when I say, that means that something which you have done, you can verify, reassure that what you have done is correct or not, whether the data in your database, which is block here, is correct or not. So verifiable, which is very, very important point of blockchain, you know. Now let's try to understand. So here we start the journey of blockchain. Okay, so as the name suggests, it should have a block. You can visualize block like this. Block will have data, right? So that's the reason we are creating a block. We want to store our data in a safe and secure fashion, which cannot be changed ever, you know. So this block will, along with the data, which is the important element, it will also have the previous hash. Okay, it will also have the hash of its own. Okay, so previous hash data and hash of its own. So these are all the elements of your block, you know, and together it forms the fingerprint of a block. That means it is as unique as your fingerprint, right? So this is what is the elementary look and feel. I mean, I can't say look and feel, elementary understanding of a block. So you will start a chain with the first block, which is also known as genesis block. And you can see that previous hash here in this case is all zeros because it is not pointing out anywhere. You know, it's the first block and it will never change throughout the life cycle of a blockchain. Second block will have a previous hash as the hash of first block, and then its own hash will be calculated. Third hash will have the hash of the second block as well as its own hash will be calculated. So this is how your chain will get created and will keep on growing. Okay, so blocks are cryptographically linked to each other. So hash is a cryptographic link between two blocks, right? So features, if we have to talk about features of blockchain, there are five important features to start with. Hash cryptography, which is the elementary feature of any blockchain, you know. Then it's characteristic, like it will keep all the data permanent. It will not allow it to change. So immutable ledger is the second feature. Its presence on distributed peer-to-peer network is the third feature, which makes it very strong. You know, nobody can change it because it is available on peer-to-peer network. Mining is the heart of the entire blockchain. We will see how it works. And then consensus protocol. So if I change, I'll inform you that, okay, I'm changing, please change. Is that enough? Is that consensus? No, that's not consensus, you know. Consensus lies where the majority are there, you know. So whatever majority says is the consensus here, you know, because it's very difficult to convince everybody to vote for you. So people are bound to be honest and truthful in this case. It is presumed and it is seen also, right? So let's start with hash cryptography. Now, hash cryptography, which is used generally and popularly with the blockchain, is SHA-256, which is secured hash algorithm, right? SHA is a short form of secured hash algorithm. Okay, let's try to understand first what is secured hash algorithm. 256. Okay, so every individual has got a fingerprint. Now this person, if he is in the group of people, still his fingerprint will be unique. So fingerprint can be thought of as a unique identifier for an individual, and there is a rarest case when you can expect the fingerprint to be common, same, you know. The research says that 1 in 60 million, which is almost negligible, right? So we can assume that fingerprints are unique identifier. 1 in 60 million, which part of the world? It's very, very difficult to get into the situation. So as fingerprint is unique, your SHA-256 is also unique. So every individual is identified through its fingerprint. Likewise, every document in this digital world is identified with the help of hash. You know? Now, when did culture or maybe the methodology of usage of hash started? It started like long back by National Security Agency of USA. And SHA-256, it is called SHA-256 because it takes 256 bits in the memory, which essentially represents 64 characters. Now, these 64 characters are nothing but the alphanumeric number, you know. So you can say 0 to 9 and A to F. So SHA-256 is, this 256 is because it takes 256 bits of memory and represent 64 character there. Right, there is SHA-512 also, which takes 512 bit of memory in the I mean, bits in the memory, right? But this is more popular, it is more efficient, it has shown the success, so this is more popular, right? So what this SHA-256 hash algorithm does is, it converts the hash for all the types of digital document. You know, whether it is PDF, whether it is video, audio, executables, operating system, whatever you take, it will convert it into exactly 256 bit of hash, right? So if you try to hash a blank document, you know, without any information, that will be converted into 256 bit of hash. If you take a document which is like one pager kind of, still it will be converted into 56 bit. If you take a book, book will also get converted into 256. If you take a videos, again that will become, so whatever material you take, it will get converted into fixed sized hash, right? So looking at that, you can't make out that what it represent. Even the blank document will have some hash associated with it. It will never be 0000 or something like that. It will have some hash, complicated hash as it is shown on your screen, right? Very, very important to understand that hash algorithm has got its own characteristic. So we need to understand that also. So it is one way, right? So every document can pass through a hash algorithm and a hash can be created for that. But from hash, you cannot create the document back. So it's one way. For a document, digital document, you can have hash created, but from that hash, you cannot get back the document. So it is one way. Deterministic, you know? A particular document, if it is unchanged and passed through the hash algorithm, it will create the same hash. If you run it n number of times, all those times it will create the same hash. Okay, so when I said like this is blockchain is a chain which is verifiable. So creating a chain is difficult, but verifying the chain is not difficult. You know, converting this document to hash is slightly difficult. To get that hash for the document is slightly difficult here in this case, right? But from hash to verify whether it is for this document or not, it's not difficult. So deterministic. Same hash will be generated each time for a particular document. Hence, it is verifiable. Fast computation, we have the algorithm, we have the computational power. So it gets executed very fast. This is important. It has got avalanche effect. So suppose a document is there which says that it is Dr. Neha Sharma, and you just make a change and add S. Forget about S. You add a dot after doctor. Okay, there was no dot in the first document. Next document, you add a dot. The entire hash will change. It will not change. It will not change, just a small part of it will change, you know, it will change entirely. Okay, so avalanche effect says that a small change in the document will change the hash completely. It will not get changed partially or bit by bit. It will change completely. And fifth and most important thing to understand, because it is a bit theoretical, that we must withstand the collision. There's rare of rarest chance that a same hash can be generated for two different document. Rare of rarest. If it is a genuine case, then we should be able to accommodate it. But if it is a fraudulent case, then we should be able to identify it and avoid it. So we need to be very, very alert, and our understanding should be very clear. Now, fifth point is about rare of rarest case, which can happen. So these are five characteristic or requirement of hash algorithm. It is one way, it is deterministic, it is, of course, it is computed very fast, avalanche effect, and it should withstand the collision, right? Now, second characteristic we move towards is immutable ledger, you know? So ledger is something where you to keep a record of anything. So immutable ledger, that means a ledger which cannot be mutated at all, cannot be you can't make any change in that particular ledger. Let me start from here, our understanding about blockchain. So our understanding about the blockchain is like blocks are cryptographically linked to each other. You know, we have previous hash and the hash of the block becomes the hash of a previous hash of the next block, something like that. So it is cryptographically linked. We have seen it, right? A couple of slides back, we have seen this. Now, to understand the immutable ledger, we have to understand the process. Let me take the example of a blockchain, which may be created for storing our property details. How it will happen in a situation where we are not using blockchain? Suppose you have money and you aspire to buy a house. Of course, you can buy. If you have money, you can buy a house. But just by paying money, this house becomes yours? No, certainly not. If you pay money to the builder, does it become yours? No. You have to sign a deed. It should come on paper. Okay. Then only your house will be in your name, right? That is also not enough. You have to sign this deed in the presence of government officers, registrar office. You have to go there and sign it in front of him or her, whosoever is there in the office, you know. And then only your property, that house, is transferred in your name or written in your name. Now, in the traditional method or traditional ledger, there is a bookkeeping, record keeping. You know, if you have ever got a chance to go to registrar office, you'll find that big registers are there where they keep on writing all the details about each one of them, complete row for one property or something like that, right? Now, when you are maintaining a tangible physical thing, you know, tangible physical thing, it is like prone to hack. Somebody can overwrite it. I mean, instead of Neha, it can be made Sneha, right? Somebody can change a slight, make a change, slightest change, and then the entire property, which was till yesterday yours, and can become somebody else's. So there is a chance of doing forgery, fraud, or in the worst situation, if nobody is trying to do a fraud, if suppose the building where your records, these records or ledgers are kept, catches fire, what will happen? Gone. And we have seen an ample example of this case where the building has caught fire and all the records are destroyed and now nothing can be done. You know, you have to you have to lose, or you have to recreate, or you have to give a proof again of your property and then it will be re-registered, something like that, you know. And the moment all of these happens, the property, there's no proof that property is yours. If somebody else comes and claims that this property is not yours and creates some document which is fraud, your property is not yours. So this is all is the problem with the traditional ledger. Now, coming to the implementation of recording the property document or property data in a blockchain. Suppose this is a blockchain which stores the data about the property, right? And here at this stage is your record. Now, if somebody wants to tamper, right, change my name with his name, right? By the time he even tries to do it, the chain would have grown, right? By the time he'll think, he'll realize, understand, think about doing it, the chain would have grown, right? Now your record is somewhere in between. The moment he will, the hacker will try to make any smallest change, you know, we have just seen the avalanche effect. The entire hash will change. And the moment the hash changes, right? The moment the hash changes, the remaining blocks of the chain will be disconnected from the main chain. So blue part of the chain will remain connected and the red part of the chain will remain unconnected, and it will get noticed. Easily it will get noticed by somebody or the other that, okay, somebody has done some tampering or something, and now it's time to take a review the situation, right? Whether the data is correct or not. So it will be noticed very soon. Now the hacker has to be real fast to make a change in this document. I mean, to ensure that the hash matches with the previous hash, and then to subsequent all the blocks. Then only probably this will remain unnoticed, and he will have to be real fast to ensure that it is done in a fraction of a second, which is highly impossible. Because your blockchain is not in isolation. It is implemented on peer-to-peer network where the records are replicated, you know, so it will not match. I'll tell you in next characteristic, I'll tell you that. But just understand about one chain, which is at your node. Somebody tries to hamper it or damage it or change it. I mean, nobody can stop it from getting noticed. Because the moment you make a change at one node, the entire chain will be disconnected because it is related. And the moment you make one change, the entire this thing becomes different and it will no more be connected. It will not affect the data. Data remains the same for the remaining change. But the hash will change, which will indicate that some problem has happened somewhere, right? So it's so easy. And why should we be using it for storing the record of property? Because this is old data for UK, where it shows that 1 lakh property per month on an average is being sold. And these properties not very small property. They are all above £40,000 and or above. So very expensive property. Every month more than 1 lakh property are being transacted, either bought or sold. So it's very important to have it implemented, the entire process of registration and selling, buying implemented on blockchain. Now coming to distributed P2P network, that is peer-to-peer network, right? Now, what does this mean? So these are the nodes, right? Peer-to-peer network means all the nodes are connected to each other. Now distributed means the same data is kept at all the nodes. So peer-to-peer network where all the nodes are connected to each other, and distributed means all the information is distributed at all the location. Now look at the complexity, which increases. I just showed you in the previous case, I just showed you of one chain. Now the same chain is replicated at multiple location. Okay, you add one new node, maybe with your property data. Okay, the same will be replicated across the network. So now the chain, that blockchain, is uniform across the network, right? The moment you add it, it will get cascaded to all the other nodes. Okay, so everybody again has got the same information, right? And then the chain keeps on growing like this. If suppose somebody wants to tamper the data of your property record, right? So the moment he tries to make a change, this will its hash will change and it will come out of the loop. And likewise, the hash of the remaining nodes will also change, and they also will come out of the loop. But then this network has got its own mechanism to check with other nodes. Okay, so it will check with others, you know, first neighbor, what is your data? Okay, it's not matching with mine. So yours can be correct or mine can be correct. So it checks with the next neighbor. Okay, again, it's not matching. Either yours can be correct. But when the majority of them have the data which is same, then this node has to accept that whatever is there with the majority is the right, and I need to replace the portion which does not matches with what matches for all, right? So it will get replaced, and then the network restores the correct data automatically. So this is how the network has been built, you know. So it has got itself mechanism to correct itself. So a hacking thing will not work here. Now, coming to the most important part of blockchain, which is mining. Now, till now, what we are saying that we are adding blocks to the chain, right? This is what I have been telling you till now, that you are adding blocks to the chain. So is it so simple that you can easily add the block to the chain? It has got two parts, you know. First is creating the block, and second one is adding block to the entire chain, right? So two element, two part of it. First, you have to create a block and then get it added. It's not necessary that if you have created a block successfully, honestly, sincerely, with correct data, it will get added to the chain. It is not mandatory that it will happen. You can't say that, okay, this is a correct data. I have done it perfectly. There's no problem in data, so my block should be added. No, it doesn't work this way here in blockchain, right? How does it work? So for that, we need to again understand and dive deep into the structure of the block. So each block will have a block number. Then the data part. Here in this case, data says that Kirill has given 500 HAD coins to Hedelin. Then Kirill again has given 100 HAD coins to eBay. Then Hedelin has given 70 HAD coins to Joe. So these are some transactions which is part of data, right? And then we said like it will have a previous hash, okay? And the new hash. Now, can you tell me, is it okay? This is what we have understood. Do you find any problem here in this case? One of you can unmute and tell me.
Ma'am, most of our viewers are on YouTube only, so.
Okay. Fine. The problem here is the data, that is blocks data, the data itself, the transaction data, and the previous hash. It is all static. Now, when you have a static data, you know what is the hash, what is going to be the hash. I have just told you that it is deterministic. When you know the data, the same data will generate same hash. So there's no pain here, you know, there's no difficulty level added here, right? With block number, which is fixed, with data, which is again the exact transaction which has happened, again fixed. Previous hash is again fixed because it is coming from the previous block, right? With this static data, how can you have a hash which is strong enough, right? So there's one more element which is added to the structure, which plays a very, very important and critical role in creating the hash of your block. That is called nonce, number used only once. This is simple integer which is used, right? Let me just explain before we go to the nonce. Let me just explain it once again. Now, suppose these two nodes have got access to the same data, right? The one which I just showed, three transactions. So this node is also aware of that data, and this node is also aware of that data. They are also trying to add it at number nine. They are also trying to add it at number nine. Now, when the data is static, block number nine, data is static, previous hash is also static, because previous hash for this node, previous hash for this node will remain same, you know, because it's the same chain, duplicacy of the same chain. So it will remain, so they will take exactly same time to create that block. Okay, I'm talking about creating the block. And once the block is created, both of them have taken fair data, nobody can stop them on the basis of hacking or malicious data or something. So it's all fair day. So they will add it to almost same at the same point of time. And when they add a block, any node, when a node adds a block, they are the miner behind this particular node will get awarded with Bitcoins. So that is what is the another motivation for blockchain miner to be truthful and do fair job, because they are awarded for getting adding fair blocks, you know. So there's no stress, you know. There's no, both the nodes have got same piece of data. They will take exactly same time to mine that hash. And once this take same time to mine that hash, they will take exactly same time to add it on the node to the chain, right? Which is not adding any difficulty level to the miner, you know. So to add that competitive edge and make it more difficult, this element has been added in calculation of this hash, which is dynamic. Rest, everything is static. This is dynamic. If nonce is, so I just told you this entire portion will be taken to calculate this hash. Now, if the nonce is 19, you can see the hash EC2B ends with 444, right? And when the nonce is 20, then the entire hash is changed. This is due to avalanche effect. The number increases just by one, right? But the hash changes totally. You keep on changing the nonce and your hash will keep on changing too, right? Now, how nonce will be selected and how it plays a critical role. Now, it plays a critical role in this way. I'll come to that. Let me just explain few more nonces have been added and I have just shown you. So let me just explain you a hash number and then we will come back to that. See how much time do we have. Okay, so this is a 64 character hash, okay, which will get generated after you pass your digital document or digital data to from this hash algorithm, right? Now this can be written as decimal also. It will just take more space. Likewise, you can take a smaller number. Again, the decimal counterpart will take smaller space. Then you can have a still smaller number. The decimal counterpart will also get reduced, right? So what essentially I want to tell you through this is, like, if all 64 character is occupied by some number or alphabet, it means that it is on the higher side. The number is towards the higher side, right? Now, if you say FFFFFF 64 times, that means that is the last number, right? In that number space. And if you say 00000 64 times, that means that is the first number in that number space, right? So if suppose this is all possible hash for 64 character hash which this algorithm generates. So FFF, all F's would be at this corner, that is top right corner, and bottom left would be all zero zeros. And these numbers, which I have just shown on your screen, lies somewhere in this space, right? So maybe somewhere on the upper part, this with less number of leading zeros will fall somewhere in the middle. Few more number of zeros will fall somewhere at the bottom of your number space, right? Now, what is the job of the controller of this blockchain? You know, there will be a puzzle which is added, right? You all can create your block, but then how the block will be considered or not considered, or how much time you take to create that block will depend on this puzzle. Now, the puzzle says, okay, the puzzle says that the hash which will be considered for your block will only be considered if the hash falls below this target line. So any hash which you create by using nonce, if it falls above this line, will not be considered. Any hash which is below this line only will be considered. So there is a puzzle which is given to the miners. So it's not that you have a static block number, static data and static previous hash, and you create a hash of that block and you are all done. You have to find out the nonce, the right nonce, which will help you create a hash which will fall below this target level, right? So this is what requires lots of computation power, lots of electricity is used, so much of manpower is used. So it's only for finding out that golden hash, you know. So let me just. So the trick is like more number of zeros if you add, the chances of getting the right hash for the final this thing golden hash will increase. Let me just show you. So and you have to start hypothetically. There's no clue for this. To solve this puzzle, there's no clue. The target is you have to have your created hash below this in this possible space of hashes. So you start with 23, anything. You can start with one also. So for example, 23, right? So with 23, you create a hash which falls there, right? At the top. Then you take 22. It falls somewhere here. Now, it essentially does not mean that as the number of nonce is decreasing, your hash placement in this place will also be decreasing. It is not possible, The moment you see with 21, it goes up. With 177, it is still down. So you have to, so the job of the miner, I mean, you must be thinking, what is the job of the miner? The job of the miner is to find out that right nonce by trying out all the numbers, till the time you get a particular hash which is below this target. The moment you get it, you can stop and try to add your block to the chain. So till here you are trying, till this step you are trying to create the block. And now you will understand that now each node will not take same time for generating the block. It will vary, whosoever gets his first has his block available first to be added to the chain, right? Now, another important concept which I want to share with you before I leave is Byzantine fault tolerance. Now, this is again very interesting concept which is used very, very frequently. In fact, it's a essential component of blockchain. So I thought let me just talk about this also. So easy way to explain you this is with this example. There's a castle and this army wants to maybe fight the people in the castle and want to win that. Okay, so the army wants to attack the castle from all the four sides, but then there has to be some strategy, to attack. If you attack the castle without any strategy, probably the chances of you to lose that battle would be high, So they say that, okay, we will communicate with each other, and only at some point of time when the leader feels that now it's the right time to enter to the castle, only and then everybody will attack. So attack will happen from all the four corners, right? So this gentleman of the army becomes the leader. And they all decide that whatever communication which will come from him, and we will follow that. But then it may happen that I mean, you may not get the right information, or somebody who is sending the information may play. So they say that, okay, what is the maximum number of yes or no you will get, attack or no attack you will get? You have to go by that. If suppose the information from maximum number of people or the soldiers are coming that you need to attack, so you need to attack. If maximum number of communication which is coming to you says that no attack, no attack. So go by majority, right? So this is what is the concept which is used in blockchain also. It goes by majority, right? It is very, very difficult to, though on the screen I have shown just four nodes from where information is coming. But in actual this thing, it is like it's very, very vast, wide, and spread out. It's very difficult to first know who all are there on the network and to convince them to convert and to vote on in your favor. It's very, very difficult. It's impossible rather, right? So consensus mechanism is considered to be one of the best mechanism which has not failed till now. So just coming to this example, so they feel that, okay, everyone will broadcast. Okay, all of them will broadcast depending on the count of the message which is received. The action needs to be taken. So since this gentleman is the king, he will initiate the broadcast. So they have decided that, okay, everyone needs to send the information to communication to everyone, and then they will count and then take right appropriate action. So king will start, you know. And one more important point is, like, there is one traitor also. Traitor, that means who will change the information and communicate. Okay. So from this king, the information goes like attack. Okay. Attack to all the three. So communication started like this. Okay. So this gentleman will communicate that I have received the information to let us first handle traitor. Okay. So traitor says that, okay, and he twisted the information and he sends back that I have received the information not to attack. Okay. So he plays with the message and send it back. Whereas other two, they say, they fairly say what they have received. Okay. They say, I have got a message from the leader to attack. And this fourth one also says that I have got a information to attack, right? Now, when you compile, first one is a king. So he knows that he has given the order to attack. So he is okay to attack, right? At that point of time. These two also have got two attacks and one no attack. So they also decide to attack. And fourth one has to follow that. He actually knows, he is receiving from all the ends that it is to attack. So he will have to attack, right? Now look at the situation where the king himself is a traitor. He plays with the messages. That means he gives two different messages to his team, right? So to two soldiers, he says that it is the time to attack. Whereas to one, he says, don't attack. Okay. So the person who has received, the soldier who has received the information about don't attack, he transmitted in that way that I have received the information, not a right time, good time to attack. Whereas other two, whatever they have received, they pass on the same. But when you compile it, wherever you have the mechanism of consensus, the majority vote will always win. Here also the same situation. So it does not affect either your team member is a traitor or even your leader is a traitor. Okay. Or he's trying to do some mischief. So if you are really interested to know about this Byzantine fault tolerance algorithm, there is so much available, you can just go through. But I have given you fair idea. I think this should be good enough to start your study. Now, the last part is consensus protocol. Okay. So, and very important. Also, so consensus protocol basically helps you to handle two problems. First is the problem of attackers, you know, somebody trying to tamper your data. So that problem also can be handled through this consensus protocol. And second one is competing chain. So in your network, if two nodes have genuinely added two fair nodes in the chain, right? Which one should survive and which one should shed off? Okay. Both of them are fair. Both of them have added correct node in the chain. So how do you handle? You cannot keep on growing chain into different directions. So somebody has to correct itself. You know, either the orange will have to correct itself or the purple will have to correct itself. Okay, so these two very prominent problems are handled with the help of consensus protocol. And it is also the background for proof of work and proof of stake and many other such kind of proofs, you know. So our understanding till this point is clear that you can create a node when you get a right nonce, which will generate a hash, which is below the target which has been given to you. So, or you can say when you solve the puzzle. This is what is the puzzle. You know, you must have heard that blockchain requires the puzzle, crypto. cryptography and all this. So the puzzle, when you talk about this, is what is the puzzle, right? So till here our understanding is clear. And the moment you create you get the golden nonce and you create that golden hash, your block is created, because now you have your own hash, you have all the data and you have your own hash, and then you are ready to add it, right? And the moment you add it, you get paid for that, okay? And if suppose you are trying to add a block which is not correct, but still you are trying to add it, somewhere as you go ahead and you check with other nodes, it will get identified, and you will have to shed that particular node, right? And then give back the money which you have received, right? So anyways, you are not earning. So being fair is the best motivation in the case of blockchain, you know. So miners are being paid for being fair, because you are investing a lot in adding that block. Your computation power is used, your manpower is used, you are continuously trying to find out that particular nonce which will help you solve that puzzle. So you are continuously using your technical power, computational power, electricity, human resource, everything is at stake. So you would like to be fair to get the correct node first and fast, and then get it added, okay? And then the moment you add it, it will get cascaded to the entire distributed network. And it does not happen like that. There are so many rules and regulation to cascade, and we need to follow all of them. And as I told you earlier also, cryptographic puzzles are hard to solve. I mean, hard to solve means you have to keep on trying till you get a number which will create a hash below that number, you know, that level, you know. But easy to verify. Once you get a hash, you know for what that hash has been created. So deterministic, right? Again, we know that once you have got that golden hash and you have created the block, you can add your node, newly created node or block, to the chain, right? Now suppose that this node and this node, both the nodes have created a block and added to the chain at almost same point of time. Let's say same point of time. So somebody sitting in Australia added a node, added a block in the chain, and somebody sitting in, say, Africa added a block in the chain, okay? Without being aware that somebody else somewhere in the corner has also done it. And the moment they add the block, their job is to cascade the information. So they will start cascading it, okay? Now, depending on the network speed, there are other factors, you know, this particular node could share it only with one neighbor, you know, whereas this particular node could share it with more neighbors. Now when this particular node will try to check it with the other, okay, they will say, no, we have got this data, we have got this data, and we have got this data. So this node will say, okay, then probably I'll have to change, right? So it will get changed, and same thing will happen with this. So even though they have done it fairly, they will have to change, you know. And imagine that it will not stop, you know. They are also growing again. They are continuously adding. So the chain will grow, and the more they grow, the more wrong they'll become, you know. So they will be left with no option but to shed these two newly added blocks from the chain and then replace it with this. And these blocks which are removed are known as orphan block. So even if your block which you have created is true, right, correct, it has to be really fast, you know, to cascade, to grow. The fast you will grow, the difficult it will be for others to change your
growth, you know. So fast in terms of fast in generating the block and also fast in cascading, both way. So you have to grow horizontally. That means your chain should grow, and you should be able to inform that you have changed to other nodes also should be fast. So both way you need to be fast, and that is where the technological advancement come into play. Lots of investment goes in to ensure that it just happens fast. Whatever correct you have done, you don't want to lose on your money, you know, because you must have got paid, and then probably you'll have to return because now your block is, the block which you have created is no more in the chain, right? So what they will do, are they going to sit idle? They will again try, and then they'll ensure that their transaction which is in the block will get added, right? So this is all I wanted to tell you. These are all few important characteristic of blockchain, which starts with hash algorithm, and we saw like SHA-256 algorithm. Then we saw how your ledger in the blockchain is almost immutable. I mean, it's immutable, you know. It's not possible till date, it's not possible to hack that. Then I just told you how this distributed peer-to-peer network works, how this mining thing works, and how this consensus protocol works. So these are few basic elements and characteristic of blockchain, and which is very essential for you to understand as you are starting your journey. Thank you so much. In case if you have any questions, you can drop to your chair of your ACM chapter, and then probably he'll convey it to me.
Great, ma'am. Thank you so much for this session, ma'am. We have two questions, but in the interest of time, I'll rather share it to you.
I'm already late, so
ma'am.
You to share it with me, and I'll surely answer.
Great, ma'am. Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone, for joining in for this session.
Bye. Take care. Bye-bye.
Bye. Thank you. Bye-bye.